fresh ways and there's real tender presence. The Lord, our Father, just never wearies, never tires of hearing us pour out a love and adoration. And I understand that we come in at times and we're feeling dry, feeling encumbered, burdened. The good thing about that is our Father knows that too. He's aware of our frame. The psalmist said that we're but dust and weak. But there's something about the very simplicity of just gently saying, God, I love you. And it's not a conjuring up, it's not a striving in the head region. We can do that. We can easily get to doing that. But it's something where we kind of just shut down the mental kind of striving and the gears turning, you know. We just kind of shut that down and say, God, Heavenly Father, in my simple place, in my alone place with you, just me and you, I just say real gently, love for me is great. No matter what I do, God, doesn't matter. You still love me. You still love me. It doesn't matter. You're there to pick me up every time. And even right now when I'm weak, even right now when I feel burdened and encumbered, you're there to pick me up. I'll always need you, God. I'll never be sufficient in my own strength. I'll never be enough. I can never cut it. But you love me. And that's so good. It's so good, God. You wash over me with your presence. You tender my heart. You melt me. You make me freshly aware of how much you really love me. And you awaken fresh things in my heart to you. You make me want to fall into your arms. You make me just want to run into your arms. There's just something about just clearing away all the head stuff and just in that simple place. It's just you and me. I really love you. I know that you love me. What more is there than this? What better thing is there than this? To be loved by the God of heaven. What better thing is there than this? So I let you love on me. I let you love on me, Heavenly Father. Pour out my heart, I pour out my love, I am yours, I am yours today. Just real gently, don't strive, don't work at it, but just gently in the very quietness of the alone place in your heart and spirit, just voice your heart to the Lord. Thank you for covering me, picking me up, and loving me more than I could know. What kind of love is this, my God? Oh, what kind of love is this that you should love on like me? my sons and my daughters, more than you ever know. But I keep pouring out my love, I keep pouring out my mercy, because I love you so. Can you see? Can you feel? Do you know? Can you receive? Oh, run into my embrace right now. Run into my arms. Run into my arms. Oh, run into my love. Yes, fall into my love. Continue worshiping, but I just feel this thing about those who have a difficulty of breaking through. God, I know you love me, but I want to feel it. God, I know you really love me. I don't doubt that in my head, but I'm having a hard time feeling it. And God, I'd like for you to just help me wash off some of the dustiness of life. Just wash off some of the heaviness of life. And so, is that all right? Call people up. If you'd like to have someone pray with you, the rest of us are going to continue worship. If you'd like to have someone pray with you, come up and there'll be several to pray. as I've been leading up here and worshiping, the Lord kind of took me by surprise. I lead worship quite a bit of the time at International House of Prayer and out on the road, and lots of times I just do this stuff, you know, I just do it. But it's wonderful when God arrests us and He takes us by surprise. It's wonderful when he shows up. He's always here, we know that. But when He comes and wraps His arms around us and we feel His presence and He awakens love, it's not just the assent that, yes, I love you. It's He awakens real love. That's kind of what's happened with me this morning. I don't know why He's doing it exactly, but I tell you one thing, that the overflow of that is, it's giving me compassion for you. And I want to kind of wash over you just a little bit with a few thoughts that I think might be, I'm sure, that are relevant to you. And that's this. Church is not an easy place to live. It should be, but I'm in lots and lots of churches. I've been a pastor for a number of years. I've been a worship leader for many years, and I'm in lots of churches. And churches, they got their problems. We got our problems personally, you know, out in life and all of our stuff, and then we come to church, and church has got its problems. We take our hits from the people who we love the most and who we think love us the most. And we try to pull up the very best. We just say, well, God, I'll just kind of buck up. Just kind of, okay, we'll just keep on going. And after a while, we're kind of tapped out as far as reserves to go anymore. We've put on our best smile, as your pastor just said a while ago, we put on our best smile. We came to church, we showed up, we said amen and hallelujah at the appropriate times. We said, how do you do? And I'm fine. We said all the good stuff, but inside there's something hollow. Inside, something still lacks. Something's haunting us. That is that our bank account, spiritually and emotionally speaking, has been too many checks written on it and not enough deposits. You know what happens when that happens? We get a notice from the bank. The notice in this case is that we just don't have any fresh thing to respond with. We don't have any fresh inspiration or fresh, oh, we have head desire, but there's not heart desire anymore. I mean, we know we're to do the right thing, and by God's grace, we'll just keep doing it till the end of our lives or Jesus shows up, because we're committed to do the right thing, right? But God, in His ways, and I don't know why He chooses certain times, He chooses just to come and visit us, take us by surprise, pick us up from our weakness, from our weak state, from our tapped out state. He chooses to reawaken us. I don't know how He does it, but He puts new currency, puts new money in our bank. He fills us up again. We have substance there to do the things that our head says we ought to do all the time. And I feel that's what the Lord wants to do this morning. Now, I can't make that happen. It's way beyond my power to make that happen. But I feel like that's what the Lord wants to do. I want to wash over you with a couple of thoughts. And like I said, I can't make this happen, but I'm feeling like there may be a few keys, that as I throw out a few things, there'll be a key that unlock a door for you. And then we'll go back into a time of ministry atmosphere, ministry worship time, and I think then we'll pray for one another if that's the thing that seems appropriate. First of all, I want to look at a couple passages, just real simple ones. Worship team, if you don't mind just kind of hanging close, is that all right? Yeah, there you go. You all right standing, Luke? Verses in Psalms say something that I believe I want to communicate to you. I think the Lord wants to communicate to you. Every one of us need to know that God is for us. That God is really for us. Again, our head says that all the time. We believe the Word of God. But something in our heart, soul, man, needs to be refreshed with that understanding. Frequently, continually, man can't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. We got to have his word, his presence over us, coming alive in us to keep us alive, our spiritual heart pumping. Take a look at, well, you don't have to if you don't want to. Try not to, I'm trying to be simple here, so if you care to, you can, but you don't have to look at these verses. This is Psalm 60. Verse 5, verse 4, David is calling out the first couple of verses. He says, God, you've cast us off and you've broken us down. You've been displeased. And he's saying, oh God, restore me again. Restore us again. He's been in a tough season. Some tough things happen. He's kind of weighed down, bowed down, broken down. He goes on and says, heal the breaches. Number 4, verse 4. You've given a banner to those who fear you, that it may be displayed because of the truth. Now listen to this in verse 5, this one phrase. It says, God, I'm asking you to do these things so that your beloved may be delivered. I don't know if you can catch this, but there's something so profound in that one phrase. David, in spite of being so broken, so beat down, and he knew that God was displeased. He said that in the first couple verses. But in spite of that, something in his heart and spirit, man, knew that he was God's beloved. He says, God, I'm asking you to do this thing so that your beloved will be delivered. Me. He's praying. He's talking about himself. So that your beloved will be delivered. Us sons and daughters of God have to know that he really does want to love on us, that he does love us and wants to deliver us. We've got to know that. David somehow seemed to know that. I think he'd evidently cultivated and God had nurtured that understanding in his heart back when he was with the sheep and tending the sheep for his father. Been delivered from the bear and the lion. He'd come to an understanding. God really did love him. Somehow he was special. But I don't know if you can get around this. He's not the only one special. You and I are too. Each one of you, very individually, I don't mean this in a corporate sense at all. I mean this individually. Each of you, by name, the way you look, the way you feel, the way you walk and the way you live, he loves you. You're his beloved. And he wants not only for you to know that, but to deliver you. Turn back a couple pages. Psalm 56. Verse 8. You number my wanderings and you put my tears in into your bottle? Are they not in your book? When I cry out to you, then my enemies will turn back. This I know. Why do I know this? Because God is for me. He's for me. All of his wanderings, you and I do some wanderings, don't we? We wander around in life. We push into this. We're exploring this, see if this works. God, is this your will? God, is this what you want me to do? We're wandering around in life, trying to follow the will of God best we know. In verse 8, he says, and you put all my tears in your bottle. Somehow he takes note of those and keeps account of them. I'm not sure why exactly. But somehow they're precious to God. He says, are they not recorded in your book? And somehow that account sets in heaven. It stays in heaven. It's held in heaven in God's view and his attention, such that when we cry out to him, that our enemies are turned back. Why does David know this? Because this thing I do know, there's one thing I know, God's for me. God's for you. David's not the only one God's for. He's for you. For you. Every one of your names, you could speak. If I knew all of you, I'd speak your name right now. I'd say it's for you. And it's truer than you can know. It's truer than you can fathom right now. It's truer than any of us would know. Even if we collectively put it together, we just couldn't know it as much as it really is true. God really is for you, Paul. Turn back a few more chapters to chapter 18. And I guess we'll start it. Maybe verse 18 says, and they confronted me in the day of my calamity, but the Lord was my support. And he also brought me out into a broad place, a large place. And he delivered me, here's the key phrase, because he delighted in me. He delights in me. Your Heavenly Father delights in you. He's for you. You're his beloved. Even in your weakness and my weakness, as I quoted the verse earlier, he knows our frame, that we're but dust. And do you know something? He picked you even knowing that. He chose you before you knew him, and he looked down the rest of your life and he saw all of your initial inspirations that, yes, God, I want to run after you the rest of my life. And then he saw when you would cool down some, and he saw when you would wander some, and he saw when you would fail. And he said, you know, that's just the one I want. That's exactly the one I want. And he chose you by name. And he called you. He saw where you're at just this morning. Some of you been able to tap in, and some of you haven't. And guess what? He knows that. He saw you in this building. He saw you be sitting here, and he said, that's the one I want. I want them. I want that one for me, for my own possession, for my own belonging. And I'll set my heart for them. My heart will be for them. I'll make them my beloved. And I'll delight in them, even in your weakness. Song of Song. this this book as being kind of a romance story, and sometimes we can tend to make it detached from us, like a drama playing out on some stage here in town or something like that. But the truth of the matter is, this is a symbolic and figurative language that applies to our relationship to the Son of God, Jesus Himself. I believe we can take every one of these metaphors, symbolic and figurative statements and phrases, and apply them to you and me. If we know the understanding of them, they'll even come more profoundly alive to us. Let's take a look at chapter 4. All this chapter except for the last verse is spoken by the Beloved, which is Jesus, your bridegroom, the one who loves you, the one who saw you eons before the earth was formed and before certainly you were ever birthed upon the face of the earth. He said, I've got a mission. I'm gonna lay down my heavenly robes, my heavenly place. I'm gonna come. I'm gonna buy you. How's he gonna buy me and you with his very own life? And you know why he does it? Why he did it? The Holy Spirit inspired Solomon to write this book that tells all about his love way before he ever laid down his life and way before you were ever born. The Holy Spirit inspired Solomon to write these things so we get a glimpse of what Jesus was looking for and what Jesus' objective was even before he appeared on the face of the earth, long before you appeared on the face of the earth. Let's take a look at just a couple verses here. Verse 1, behold, Jesus says to you, behold, you are fair, my love. Behold, you are fair, which means delightful to look upon. It's great to look upon you. You have to bear in mind that we're not talking about him looking upon the maiden when she's in absolute perfection. He's looking on her in her normal present state. And he said, what I see is wonderful. And verse 9. You have ravished my heart, my sister, my spouse. Remember, Jesus, our bridegroom, we're his bride. You've ravished my heart with one look of your eyes. How fair is your love, my sister, my spouse, and so much better than wine is your love. That's Jesus saying that over you. He loves you. He loves you. He felt this way about you hundreds of years before he came to earth to buy you. Thousands of years before you came upon the face of the earth. And he knew all about your weakness today. He knew all about your struggles and your pains and our disappointments. He knew all about those. And yet he said, in the midst of knowing all of that, he says, you've ravished my heart. When this morning you come to meet him, as you've done over the last hour and will do yet before we go home, or any time in your closet, any time in your car this week, and you place 1 ounce of energy present yourself to the Lord and say, God, here I am. You melt his heart. You ravish his heart. He looks down. That's my bride. That's the one that I gave my life for. That's the one that captures my heart. Why am I telling you about his love for you? Because It's not possible for us to love without being loved, first of all. We don't have that capacity. God's the creator of love, the origination of love. He's the embodiment of love. We have to know that He loves us before we can love back, love Him back, or love each other. So this morning I'm just washing over you. He loves you. Can you see it? Do you know it? He really does love you. I wish I had a way. This is a special morning for me. It really is. It's not just professional language. This is a special morning for me. God's very tender for me this morning. I really don't know why. I wish I had a way of turning that on for you. He really does love you. He's aware of every one of your strains and pains. And when you're pressing in, God, I'm trying to come. I'm trying to come in. God, I'm trying to love you. I'm trying to press in. You're like an ox going through a rainforest with all the vines turning on. Here I come. God, I'm coming, you know. He's aware. And He loves you so dearly. Holy Spirit, I ask that you'd make the connection. That you'd turn the key. You'd unlock our hearts. Unlock our hearts today. Fill us with the love of God. Fill us with the love of God. Let's say that together. Fill us with the love of God. Again, fill us with the love of God. Fill our hearts, Holy Spirit. Tears. It's a wonderful sign. In fact, I just want to stop just a second here, not going any further. I want to pray that God give you the gift of tears. About 5 years ago, Paul Kane prayed that, prophesied over that over Debbie and I at a conference downtown. And since then, many places we've gone, God just visited. Tears, and not only while we were there, but afterwards, it seemed to be a deposit. You say, well, what's special about tears? Tears to me signify the unlocking of the heart, just pure and simple. It signifies to me the breath of God, the touch of God, where it unlocks our hearts. Otherwise, we're just hard brain waves. When God comes in touch, it does something down deeper than we can really analyze. Can't reason it and logically figure it out. It's just like, I'm different. Something's tender. I don't know why God chooses to do it, and I can't predict when He's going to do it. I want to pray that over you. Holy Spirit, I ask that you would release the gift of tears upon this congregation and every individual. Tears, God, that would bring refreshing. Tears that would bring cleansing. Tears that would make whole. Tears that heal. Tears that restore. And tears that come from great joy. Tears that come when we're empowered. I ask for the gift of tears to be poured out. Every individual, God, I ask. In their course of life, in their journey of searching for you and living for you, I ask God that you would suddenly surprise, interrupt and invade their hearts and lives. They're laying their head upon the pillow at night. In the middle of the night, I ask that you wake up. They'd wake up, God, and they'd find the presence of God upon them, and tears would flow. Tears, God, that would bring refreshing and wholeness, fresh love, first love, tenderness of heart, washing away the callousness, washing away the callous and the lethargy and the complacency, washing away the striving. I ask for fresh tears, the gift of tears to be released in this congregation. And God, for the leaders, I ask for the gift of tears, tender hearts, hearts made tender. Let it be so, Holy Spirit. God, in the course of driving down the road, and God, just take them by surprise, I ask that you would come in the back door of their heart, back door of their mind, and not even thinking about it, and all of a sudden, what is that I feel? Tenderness. Tenderness. I ask, God, that you'd invade, interrupt, apprehend us. For fresh tenderness, the spilling over of tears. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Thank you for the work that you've done in our midst this morning, Holy Spirit. We invited you at the very beginning. We asked you to come, and you did. You did. You did. You did. You came. You met us. You helped us touch the Father. Holy Spirit, I ask for the seeds of life. The seeds are truly from the Father. We bear forth much fruit. Bring forth much fruit. Tenderness of heart would be the word of the day. Tenderness of heart would be the state of our lives. The presence of the Lord would be our bread, be our portion. So many times. We're truly grateful for how you reveal the Father's heart and help us to see Him and find Him, love Him, receive His love. We love you, Holy Spirit. Thank you.
and the moon forgets to shine until heaven's blue is erased from the sky. Even longer I love you, this I promise, I love you. My word I give is true, I love you.
Tenderness of heart would be the state of our lives. The presence of the Lord would be our bread, be our portion. Thank you, Holy Spirit. You've helped us so many times. We're truly grateful for how you reveal the Father's heart and help us to see Him and find Him. Love Him. Receive His love. We love you, Holy Spirit. Thank you.